We take for granted small creatures like bees, but they play a crucial role in our survival. If they're one pollinator, apples, nuts, pumpkins, and actually about 75% of all fruits and vegetables, we just won't have them.
There's a famine there for pollinators.
Intense agriculture destroys their habitat by using chemicals and pesticides.
Not everybody likes it. I'll be honest, not everybody likes it.
Bee conservationists in Ireland have a solution to this problem. And that's why we are here.
Don't mess with the bees.
We met Pat from Irish Bee Conservation Project and went inspecting some of the installed wild bee lodges.
Yes, I see you there.
34, is it?
Yeah.
There's an accommodation crisis, but there's also a forage crisis. So if there's less food for the bees, there's going to be less food for the humans and the animals. So it's really is creating habitat is what we're doing, and letting them wild and free. Look, if they're left out there to fend for themselves without any interference, that's the future.
To see bees in action, we visited community garden just outside Cork, where volunteers are growing vegetables next to the wild bees. And such collaboration benefits both bees and humans.
You can see the apples, see all the flowers that are out in the apple trees along there?
Yeah.
So that the bees now will pollinate the apples, and that's how you get the apples. We don't take honey from them, that's their food.
Right.
Like the potatoes now will come up with flowers in another few weeks, and the chives that are here, the bees now will eat the pollen out without the chives.
We were lucky to catch an unique moment when bees start to swarm. They split to form a new colony, and about half of them are leaving the original hive to find a new home.
There's really a lot.
Okay.
It's not comfortable, like your head or anything. Yeah. Just stand still. Ah.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, I was stuck. Ah. I was stuck.
Oh, no.
Go in.
Oh, it's painful. Here and
no.
There.
Oh.
It hurts so much.
Yeah. I'll give you antihistamine. Do you want antihistamine?
This is steroid solution.
Yeah, I think here. Well, somewhere.
Because I took the sting out.
Oh yeah, you got it out in time.
It's okay. Just I'm a little.
Something.
Don't mess with the bees.
Do you know what Pat actually?
Look, they're formed like two hives behind me.
Is that happening just now?
Yeah.
So they just did it.
Yeah, they were moving from this box to there.
Okay,
that's,
see,
that's what
that.
Happened. That's why they attacked.
I got a Fanta for free, so it's not that bad after all. Just soothe my pain.
When you talk about bees, everybody talks about honey. Everybody talks about the honeybee. And there is very little research being done on solitary bees. We're the only organization concerned about all bee species. Their life cycle is 6 weeks, so for 6 weeks of the year, they work, and for the rest of the year, they're in a sleep stage, really. And so when they see a hole, that's natural to them to live in there. So, oh, yeah, they're all different sizes
species.
Because they're different species. Yeah, you're right, Billy. Yeah.
Their habitat has been wiped out by man as well, so what we're trying to do is provide habitat by just putting up those posts. And the bigger the hole, the deeper it has to be. Nearly all the way in, like, without kind of breaking out the other side. The leaf cutter bees use, you know, cut up leaves. Other bees just kind of use mud, and they just block it off, and then they fly off and they die. And then this is the next generation.
They are under enormous pressures from climate change and from modern uses of herbicides and insecticides. And it's a famine. There's a famine there for pollinators.
And to see that famine, we don't have to drive far. All around Ireland, there are many fields, and some of them stand out with a dark brown colour.
Burnt off the field with weed killer and kills everything, and then they'll harrow it and plough it and resow it, probably with more grass seed into it. But they're just looking for a clean, green, monoculture field. There needs to be multi-species in there, because all of these have benefits for the animals as such, and the pollinators.
So basically they just kill everything.
Yes.
But it shouldn't be that way. There are much better ways of farming. We're meeting Mike, who will introduce us to some of his methods.
This mixture here, we have 15 different plant species, legumes and herbs mainly, but then we'll have maybe 5 or 6 or more natural species coming in, like the dandelion. That just came in on its own because we're not using chemicals to knock it out. If we come in here and put chemical fertilizers on this ground here, within 2 years, we'll have lost most of those broadleaves, and it's just some of the grasses that will persist. So these would normally be classed as weeds, but I say for us they're all plants because the cows eat them, and nutritionally they're quite good. Barley plant, no chemicals, no sprays, no disease, very clean. The only thing we did with that is we didn't give it any chemical treatment of any kind. We are achieving above the national average in terms of our forage production. It's zero chemicals.
The question is, why so many farmers use chemicals then?
That's a very good question. And I think the answer is marketing, advertising, and I'll go as far as saying misinformation.
And there should be some benefit.
There's less efficiency in the system. There's benefit to the agribusiness sector.
Yeah.
There's benefit to the fertilizer industry.
Green grass on its own is no good. We have to have something in with that. You're trying to sustain the living that's under the soil as what's above the soil. That if there's insects coming out of the ground, there'll be more birds about, there'll be more pollinators about, and there'll be healthier animal life as well. And eventually, and people are forgetting about it, that the human race are at the top of that chain and they haven't actually seen it yet, what's going to happen. So you will have a very healthy community producing a healthier and more sustainable living for insect life there.
And it's not only farmers who take care of the insects. We went to Fota Arboretum, where they do incredible and innovative things for pollinators.
When we plant these beds, we'll have a combination of vegetables, pollinator-friendly flowers as well too. So in this one, we had pumpkins here last year.
Wow.
But then we'd have the standard then kind of ones, let's say like the beetroots, the cabbages, peas, the beans. When we started 2 years ago, it was a whole new idea for people, where we had roses before, so people visually saw the garden as a colourful, ornamental garden. We're really putting a different mindset in people's heads, that your garden doesn't have to be perfect. The biggest one for people to get their heads around is the uncut grass though. But the fact that when we tell them that we can make a crop out of it and we can let the wildflowers establish it, cut it then later in the summer, make hay out of it and take it to somewhere where it is used, rather than being a waste product. Because we're pushing boundaries in people's mindsets. Not everybody likes it. I'll be honest, not everybody likes it, kind of. But it's really just pushing it out there, you know. And you'll win some and you lose some. We've moved away from the whole mowing as much as we can. Even the main arboretum, we'd have been cutting it every fortnight for nearly 3 days. We had 2 mowers going around it, cutting it. Now we cut it once a year. Okay, so that's a huge impact then, obviously. And it's not just an impact in terms of, you know, the diesel we save and the impact in this, but it just makes the garden so much quieter. And even as we were talking to me, you know, I can hear the birds in the background, let's say, singing away there. Now, if we had mowers and machines and everything else going on, you don't hear that, you know. So I'm hoping that, obviously, let's say, in quietening down the garden, people actually interact and listen more and they hear more, let's say, of nature around them. Yeah, put one across there. Yes.
Like this.
Yeah.
I'll put maybe a plant, one plant.
Oh yeah.
It will grow and it will make this garden even more beautiful.
Cool.
Now
down nice and deep. Down nice and deep. That's it.
Nice.
Now, job done. Yeah.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it. Now I have to start my own garden.
After I was stung, I was quite hesitant to come close to the bees again.
You're okay. Something's in my hair now, that they like.
These would have been the experimental ones that we started off with, trying to figure out what would work and wouldn't. And they were all occupied extremely fast. So we're very pleased with what has happened. So the first out is the male, second out is the female. And the minute they're out, the first thing they want to do is mate, and then move on from there. So today is a beautiful day, and that's why they're all out.
So as we're traveling more and more through Ireland, we see more of those posts everywhere. So it's on all kinds of parks and trails like this.
Pat introduced us to the bee posts. So we've 16 of them around the place, in different places. There's one in the school here, every single hole in it had eggs.
even in more distant places. Like, for example, here. Such a spectacular view.
But it's never enough, right? That's why we are on our way to install more of them.
On this trail, we're looking for the perfect place for our lodge post.
Bee lodge posts not only provide crucial habitat for solitary bees,
yeah, big man,
but also information both in English and Irish languages.
We're waiting for the bees now. The hotel is here. I think they should find their way on their own. They're very nice, comfortable holes. A lot of them.
In a colony of bumblebees, you may have 90 bumblebees, but in a colony of honeybees, you could have 40,000. And in solitary bees, then you're talking one. So it's a there's competition between the species then for the little food that's out there. So if there isn't enough food out there, it means that one species becomes more dominant because they're better and more aggressive at getting their foods because they're in numbers. The honeybee actually and the bumblebee are not as effective for pollination as the solitary bee. The honeybee and the bumblebee wax the pollen to their back legs, so on the way back they'll bring back that to the nest site, whereas with the solitary bee will either cover its body or put it on its back legs, but it's not waxed, so on the way back to its nesting site it loses about 50% of the pollen it has collected, so it's actually pollinating far better and the honeybee or the bumblebee.
Okay. Our sense of smell is for humans is so bad. I'm very disappointed about it because I love smelling flowers all the time. If we think there's no scent, they actually do, but we don't feel it. So that's a pity.
We all had that smell, but we have lost it because the air is polluted, yeah, and our sense of smell is gone down because we don't need to use smell anymore to forage, right? So if you're foraging, your smell would be very important.
So their smell is definitely better than ours.
A million times better.
This one is a brilliant source of nectar and pollen for bumblebees and honeybees. People think they're weeds, but like they're not. They're a real lifesaver for pollinators that emerge during the spring. I'm a beekeeper, so I breed a native black bee. Our native bee is more acclimatized to that kind of weather. They're used to that kind of cold, damp weather, you know what I mean? They're only kind of in Ireland, all over Europe. Most of them are hybridized. There is a few patches maybe of native black bees. Once you lose your genetics, once it's gone, you can't get it back again, you know what I mean? It's gone forever, that's the end.
We'll have the costumes. Yeah. Like a real beekeeper.
He's going to bring us the bathroom.
So I'll do everything what I'm told to do. So I won't do anything stupid. I have to hide my hair.
I want to feel myself protected, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel that way.
Yeah, it keeps
the smoke going.
Do it all the time. We use the smoke to control them.
20,000. Wow.
That's all the pollen that the bees are bringing in on their legs. See, if we dig it out, you see the colour of it here? That's their protein. See all the different colours? You see, so they have a big variety. They have a mixture of pollens, all different plants that they work, you see, and this is all honey inside here. Now here's our queen.
A queen? Where?
She's green, yeah. So the queen has a sting. She only uses her sting to fight another queen. If there's two queens in the hive, they'll fight. They'll kill one another. The strongest survives, basically.
When we look at it, we see a total chaos, but they're so well organized and they have this structure within.
I found it a bit scary at first. I don't know.
Yeah?
It doesn't feel like so much protected when they're like flying around your face.
Right, yeah. I just try not to look, yeah.
last 50 years, more has happened to nature than it has happened in 5,000 and maybe 50,000 years. So nature has been pressurized by commercial bodies who are pushing for their product to be used. It's driven by profit. And farmers have to make a living, and that's great, but they should be subsidized or given a fair price for their product if they conform to a more green economy.
This is Sol3B, 3D printed lodge, so you can make one yourself. And also we will put in some straws, and they are different sizes, biodegradable straws, not the plastic ones. These are from bamboo. And paper straws also help you work. Ooh. And then you put it in, and it won't take that long, and then you can put it in your garden. So this is how it looks when installed. I think it's pretty beautiful. It has to be 1.5 meters tall, that's important. And now it's time to wait for the bees to come.
If you have 3D printer and you want to print your own bee lodge, the link will be under this video.
And if you'd like to volunteer for Irish Bee Conservation Project, the link will be also in description.
Thank you for watching. If you like our videos, subscribe to our channel, support us on Patreon.
And be brave to act.